Hello, everyone. I have an apology to make. Trump is president because of me. I wished he would run against Hillary because I figured cartoonists would have a great time with him. And I was right. And I was wrong. So he's our president. And what I wanted to do at first was ignore the fact that it existed. Steve Brodner called me a few times and said, what are we going to do about this? And I said, I don't know what you're going to do about this, but I'm going to read literature for the rest of my 4 years. But we've gotten to the point where dysfunctionality is no longer funny, but needs to be addressed. During the campaign, this was my favorite of all the Trump images. It was done by a street artist named Hanksy. My son has done some documentary videos on. And they went down to North Carolina to protest in front of a couple of the rallies they had. And in those earlier days, there weren't that many people around, so the police could actually protect the demonstrators. I think they protected them by hitting them with clubs. But Trump apparently got up on stage, it's on tape, and he said, so some guys out there showing me like a potato. So it has multiple uses. Recently, let's just see whether this is working the way it should. Recently, I was asked to do a documentary video on the resurgence of protest posters. And the reporter who was talking to me from Newsweek started finding a lot of things that were co-opting what the left used to do in the old days of protest, doing these art brute kind of images, things that looked like they were done by high school students who couldn't get through gym, so they became art students. This is just some of the remarkable work that's being done in favor of Trump. There is also, some of you may remember during the Bush administration, the administration that we now long for with all our hearts, particularly now that he's become a painter and soon to be a painter. Mika Wright was a Photoshop artist who was co-opting and repurposing patriotic posters against the war in the Gulf. And so now the right wing has found their way into this delightful way of working. Oops. They've taken our dearest icons and have made them their own, which is always a problem with cartooning and graphic design. It can be a double-edged sword. This is one I particularly love. So today we're here to talk to two of the, from, in my opinion, the finest of the anti-Trumpists who have worked consistently in the public media, on the streets of the city, on Facebook and other social media, getting the images out of our current leader-in-chief. They're going to talk each a bit about the work that they're doing, and then they'll have a conversation, whether it makes any sense or not, whether it's doing any good or not, what is to be expected in the future, since we're not even 3 months into his presidency. And I hope that people in the audience will also address the issue by asking questions and making statements. And if we don't like the statements or questions, we'll just call Sean Spicer in and go do what he does so brilliantly, as we're told. They will introduce themselves insofar as I'm sure you know Steve Brodner and Adele Rodriguez. from their work, if not from their various speaking engagements. By the way, I'm Steve Heller. I'm the other bald one. And I once learned that clear water hides nothing, but never mind. So we're going to start with Steve, who I've now known for 40 years, and he's gotten better with time and more beautiful.
These are acts of nature, and you can't argue with them. Thank you, Steve. I don't know how many people know this, but Steve Heller is the preeminent voice speaking on behalf of graphic arts, I believe in this country, maybe even the world. But more than that, he is a great bringer of graphic art excellence. Not only at SVA, where he is now ensconced, but also when I knew him, and for how long were you at the Times? Over 30 years, right?
33
years editing, editing, I would say, too, and art directing the book review. I would say any collection of illustrators, if you raise, ask for a show of hands, how many of you got your start at Steve Book Review? You'd see a tremendous number of hands. Because Steve believed in always seeing everybody. You have a portfolio, Steve would see you, even if you sucked. And if you sucked, he would tell you immediately that you sucked. But at least he saw you. And if you had, you know, French term, chutzpah, you would come back when you had different work and he'd see you again. And then you might have a career. And I was very lucky. He plucked me from a job as a daily political cartoonist that was going nowhere. And he said, you've got the right style for certain kinds of things in the book review, and then I was off on a career. So I'm very grateful to Steve for so many things, and we all are. Here is a portrait of this creature. I don't know what to say about him. I think the existence, the very existence of Donald Trump is a hilarious self-parody, a commentary on American culture. But the fact that he becomes president of the United States speaks volumes in so many ways about us. I don't think that it's within the purview of any of us to historically place this. I think it's going to be for people in the future to actually characterize. You know, history is a thing that we are comfortable about talking about because we all know how it ends. We know how World War II ends, right? But in World War II, you don't know how it ends. If you're talking to someone in 1942, you really don't know where it's going. And we don't really know right now. We've seen a real turn where this scary thing is now scary, but also deeply, clearly incompetent. That it's, as Jimmy Breslin, to quote the late, great Jimmy, it's the gang that couldn't shoot straight. Thank goodness, you know, thank goodness. So whatever their evil plans are, they're not able to carry them out. So I'm going to flip through quickly some of the work I've done in the, just in the past year. I'm starting. This is not me. This is not me. I'm starting with people who I admire.
Oh, really?
Okay. And the man who did this is sitting to my left.
He works. What you picked.
I love it. He does an illustration that's this big in the Washington Spectator, but because Edel is such a perfectionist, he puts just as much care in the thinking. Maybe not as much time, but in the thinking behind this little tiny spot every, was it every week? Every
yeah,
2 weeks?
Every 2 weeks.
For Hamilton Fish's little publication.
You get that?
I still get it. And I love it. Lou DeBose.
Okay.
And, but look at the brilliance of it. It's just simple, fascinating combination, a mashup. Because that's what illustration is, it's a mashup.
And you'll never forget.
You'll never forget.
It packs a derm. Next. Another art director turned illustrator, Brian Stauffer. And this is a recent piece by him, enough said, right? About Trump's. So, there, again, mashup, kind of a collage idea, but absolutely eloquent. Next, okay. The guy, this guy's in the back of the house, but he's really very modest. As geniuses should be, Victor Juhas. He is the signature artist for Rolling Stone, who's now the subject of films. So he's going to become a star of stage, screen, and magazines. The reason I first, Vic has been consistently coming out with some of the most powerful stuff. But I was thinking about this one recently, that only since the healthcare debacle are we really seeing him this way. So a lot of people have been doing the clown Trump thing, no one as well as Vic, but this thing was speculative. But since that time, it has become a better illustration because Trump is now fitting the meme. He's fitting the metaphor. Now, this is really, Vic, I'm sorry, even more brilliant now because Trump has fulfilled the prophecy. So illustration can change or also can become delegitimized by the turn of events. And I'll show you next how I'm working on something where it's a turn of events that have forced me to make a lot of changes. This is a view of the Trump Oval Office and the internecine wars that are going on between the what's called the New York liberals, Jared Kushner and his gang, and Steve Bannon and his gang. And but as this is the first version of it, in which it's foreign policy. But since the healthcare thing, I've had to make changes. But here's that was Bannon and Mattis. Here's Priebus and Miller. Next. Mike Pence wielding a gun, which is absolutely in character, even though we don't think of him that way. That's the way I think of him. And then if you click to the next one, you see, Sebastian Gorka. Raise your hand if you know who that is. So, oh, two people, three people. Okay.
He's right outside.
He's right outside, goose-stepping in front of the door. Anyway, he's one of those Nazi-loving Trumpists. And there's Trump himself paying careful attention only to Twitter and his own image on the TV screen. So if you back off, you can see the whole composition. And there it is. And this is for the LA Times. But now I'm changing. I'm after healthcare, I'm changing some heads. Because that's how fast the news is moving. You have to replace some heads. So this
have
is going to run
have
next
your, images of Trump changed in the last year? Have you changed the way you draw him? Or is
yeah,
the feeling that goes into the
drawing? I think I'm drawing him more
of
as a buffoon. And the next one you'll see that. There he is. as sort of a parody of Goya's King Charles IV, where it's amazingly a caricature of the royal family. And they loved it, apparently. Not having the capacity to see what he was up to. So I just went crazy. I put everybody in this portrait. It had 42 heads. And LA Times ran it across two standard-sized pages on the Sunday of the inauguration. So Putin is on the right, and Kushner and Ivanka have baby Priebus. And on the bottom, you can see where Kushner is stepping on Chris Christie's head. And I don't think I left anybody out, except for Spicer. He became a star later.
What's he drinking from the cup?
He's got oil. That's okay. Tillerson, who's addicted to basically crude. He likes a little more crude than most other people.
I think you weren't as flattering to Kellyanne as she deserves.
I'll have more chances. But also, Bannon, I think I was a little nice too. Here's more of the royal family, and the two Uday and Kuse are on the leopard. They get killed, and there's Melania and various others. And that's the whole gang. 42 heads. And again, I had to keep scratching out and putting more in as people rose and fell in the process. Next. This is for Rick. Rick, this is for the Bystander. Okay, thanks to Rick, I got in touch with the American Bystander, and I did this for them. Next. This is for the New Republic. So a lot of the way I work is I come up with ideas and then I pitch them. So most of these things that you're seeing are just things that I come up with and I contact editors and art directors. How about this? How about this? And they say no. And then I go to someone else, and down the line they eventually say yes. So that's the way I work, and it makes me, I think, a little more bulletproof as an illustrator. Next.
Well, bulletproof is an interesting point.
Bulletproof, 45.
How, you know, we still do have a constitution. So you're not going to get bashed in the way that, you're not going to get a blacklist mark on it. The media still is an independent media. Do you feel that you can make use of our freedoms as much as possible now more than other times?
Yeah. Or are you, I would still say even more in the last couple of weeks, really, that I think that people are no longer afraid of him. When you have a 35% approval rating, that means that part of your core support is peeling away. And when that happens, I don't think we've begun to see how this is going to crumble. But you have to have some verifiable proof of power. And he's failing on every conceivable front. I think the media are now starting to say, okay, we're going to tell the truth. Scott Pelley on CBS calls it a lie when he sees it. New York Times has lie in the headline now. That never used to happen under any other president. There's a growing level of courage on the part of the press. New York Times, I had spoke with a friend of mine who's an art director, Kelly Doe, the other day. She says subscriptions are soaring at the New York Times.
Every time Trump mentions the Times, they soar.
Washington
and then
Post.
They go down again, and then the same people sign up again.
I started getting the print edition again after a couple of years. And I'm realizing print, even though it's fading, is a much better delivery system for news. It just is. Mm-hmm. Washington Post. The Nation is doing well. So you're only going to get positive vibes from me. I'm feeling good about where we are now.
Yeah, I noticed how optimistic you were, and I felt that went so counter to my own personality.
Some of what happens with the media here is that they go one way so long and they screw up, and then they have to come back and make up for the screw up.
Right.
So it's what happened in the New York Times with Iraq. They pushed the Iraq war because the weapons of mass destruction, this, and then they're like, oh my God, we screwed up, we gotta fix it, this way. So that's what's happening now.
And they get rid of Junior Miller.
Every headline on the New York Times website during the primaries and was Trump goes to the bathroom. Trump, because they were trying to get hits. They were trying to get interest,
clickbait.
Online, clickbait, all that stuff. And then they realized what they did, and now they're like, oh, you know, we gotta change. And it's all about storylines.
It's also about popularity.
Yeah.
You see now he's described as a deeply unpopular president. The presidency is about power. And the minute a person is branded as not only unpopular, but deeply unpopular, all hell breaks loose.
Well, branding is an important part of his whole life, and what you guys are doing is the anti-brand. And it'll be interesting to see how that anti-brand plays out over time. I find, personally, that the TV hosts who are anti-Trump are getting tiresome because there's no answer at the end of the joke. It's the joke. And I feel differently about the way artists work because you can mull over that piece of work for a while.
Well, we're in the middle of a serious investigation into possible espionage and treason. So that storyline is keeping everybody galvanized. I don't know if it's tiresome yet. It would be tiresome if there wasn't that, more tiresome if there wasn't that. And it was just, you know, yammering. But I'm not seeing that it's yammering right now. I'm seeing there's a developing narrative where this is possibly more serious than Watergate.
Well, let's go back to you.
This is my first Trump. And I did this for Spy magazine, if you're old enough to remember Spy. And that was for an editor who was the first person to call him a short-figured Bulgarian.
Really?
Graydon Carter. You know that Trump, all these years, has been sending photos to Graydon, circling his hands in a gold line, saying, you see, these are not really small. So this is from, I believe, 88 or 89,
wow.
Where they took some kind of an advertorial poll and they asked me to do it. As Lady Gaga, exhibitionist, this is for a video that I made for Slate, I think, a number of years ago. Next. All right, so here's, we'll go to the campaign. Early in the campaign, he's not even visible. No one is thinking about Trump. Here's like the early morning line. Hillary I got right, but the rest of them, no dice. This is for Newsweek. Next.
Have you had anybody at any of these media look at a caricature and say, too hard, too brutal?
No, not anymore. I think when they call me, they know what they're getting. So they're happy. This was going to be a Time cover, you know.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, it was. And then they decided no, and it became a full page in Time, which I was happy for. Trump providing his own gas, a self-perpetuating mechanism of the Trump ascendancy. I can't explain this at all, except to say it was for a series that I wrote for the LA Times on ways in which you could get Trump, and I said, if you could find this photo from his wedding where he was caught in the closet with Hillary, that would be one way to get Trump. So it just wound up having a life of its own.
What I like a lot about this is that you don't use an incandescent.
Exactly.
Exactly. Right on.
We make progress in small ways. All right, so now I'm doing convention coverage for the Village Voice, where I'm not at the convention, but I'm just watching it on TV with an assistant, one of my students from SVA, and I'm drawing these drawings really fast, tearing it out of the sketchbook, giving it to him, he's scanning, coloring, sending it to the Voice, and I did 156.
You did go around the country, though, didn't you?
Not this time.
In the past,
I have. I covered 8 conventions live.
Did this convention have any special resonance for you other than what the result was?
It was totally bizarre, surreal convention, as if it were written by Monty Python. Just completely out there, and it was one grotesquerie after another. And it really did, I felt it was outstripping our capacity to draw it and satirize it, which is a drag, in reality is satirizing itself. All you have to do is like John Stewart would just run the tape and then look at the camera like. So, but I gave it a good try. These are some of the sketches from that. Are we having a good time? Here he is giving his acceptance speech. Thanks to my dad, Mrs. Slumlord, who started all this. And he was a KKK guy.
Really?
Yeah. New York Times article from 1928 has him arrested or involved. His name is involved in a Klan incident in Queens. It's hard to imagine in the 20s the Klan was strong in Queens, but they were.
Well, they took over Washington.
In 25, 250,000. Ivanka is trying to tell us how sweet he is, and I felt that, like, if you just add a little water, I made you laugh, I'm so happy. I still care what he cares, what he thinks about me so much. My portrait of Paul Ryan. It still holds for today, I think.
When did you do this?
During the convention.
Very much for today.
Yeah.
This is my favorite only because of my affinity for Germans and how wonderful they are.
Speaking of Germans, this one you. Yeah. So I gave him a Teutonic helmet where he's got the raised finger in the middle. That's how I saw it.
So from a drawing perspective, Trump versus Obama, Trump versus Bush, what joy level?
Extreme. But only because, we have a bunch of caricaturists here. Victor's in the back, and Rick Meyerowitz is over here, and probably a smattering of you guys in the audience. You know that what caricature is what good caricature is the attempt to bring what's under the surface to the surface. So everything has meaning, okay? Caricature is illustration writ small. It's the features of the face that you are now twisting and manipulating to tell a story. So it's not about making big things bigger and small things smaller. No, it's about telling your story with a face. And David Levine would always lengthen the lower eyelids, eyelashes in Richard Nixon. And I believed he did that to suggest decadence, almost like a transvestite's makeup that he put. And I asked David about it. He says, I don't know what the hell you're talking about. But I think it was instinctive with him.
If I can just interrupt for a second, speaking of Rick Marwitz, the first drawing I ever assigned when I was 17 was to Rick. And he did two. One, J. Edgar Hoover in drag, which was still at the time a rumor. And the other was Spiro Agnew as a prophylactic on a penis. And it was the most perfect rendering ever.
You got to always work for 17-year-old art directors. They have the best ideas.
Well, I knew what a penis was.
Back to you.
So I did this for the conventions also. It wasn't as spontaneous. I took a little amount of time with it. But it just sort of felt right for me at the time.
But don't you feel that you've done harm to the Flintstones?
I think it's worth it. Here's a bunch of covers. A good number for The Nation. This is Trump is appealing to workers. None of them are really too happy about it, but they've all shown up for the talk. John Nichols. Here's Village Voice as a sort of toy fascist. You take a picture of the little it creature, and then on the screen he seems different.
When do you know you've got your idea? I mean, you must have tons of them.
I need a couple.
That aren't good.
I need a couple of days, and this is really so mysterious. I'd like to hear what you think of this, though. When of all your sketches, the one that just says yes, I feel it in here. I feel there's a kind of a visceral thing that says yes. Like a charge. It's an actual physical. You're nodding. You've had this experience, where you're looking at all these ideas, and then finally, you know, I did a Huckabee for Politico, where he's doing a selfie because it's his life as an evangelical Christian, and he's taking a picture with a selfie stick, and it's okay. And I came in the next morning. I looked at it and I said, no. The selfie stick should be a cross. It should be a white cross with a little camera on the top. He's doing, and then, bang, I got that feeling. I was absolutely like this, wow, yeah, it's getting born, you know?
I usually look and I go, oh my God, this is so wrong. And then it's right. That's how I feel.
When it says no first?
When it says, oh God, yeah, then it's like a good idea.
Well, you've had quite a few which we'll get into very soon.
Well, my advice is to do lots of sketches. Lots and lots of sketches. So that so each thing can be judged against the next thing, and then additional sketches can steal pieces from the other sketches that you can then put together, okay? That kind of thinking doesn't happen without real a kind of zen that you go into, where you've taken all your devices and your phones and everything, you pushed it away, and you're there for 90 minutes, 2 hours, and allowing things to enter and to calm yourself down.
You work so hard.
You think? Trying to get it right. I'm trying to get it right. One of these days. This was an idea from the art director, Andrew Horton. So I didn't have to worry about the idea. I just had to do it. But I thought it was kind of dead on. Okay, so now Trump wins the election, and The Nation is really kind of bearish about strong ideas. So I had a lot of tough ideas about punching Trump in the face, and then they settled for eyes. But you see, I'm stealing a little bit from Adele here, because I just decided, let's make them all orange. So you had an influence on me there. Saw that. Going in the wrong direction.
Going in the wrong direction. It's because I'm a lefty.
There's a downside to everything. Another cover for The Nation, where I just got to draw a group shot of the people who are now going to go to Washington and demonstrate. So I didn't draw any pussy hats, but I drew Muslims, blacks, gays, and the Rockettes. And a polar bear was pissed off, and Meryl Streep was back there with her award, kicking butt. And they really liked it. Cover for Harper's. all orange also. Those two things appeared the same week. Stronger word.
I heard that Alec Baldwin picked up some of his mannerisms from you and Barry Blitt.
Well, I'm not sure exactly what he said, because I found out about it when I was waiting online to vote, but it was on election day, and he was on the Brian Lehrer show, and Rick told me about it too. She asked him, how do you get your ideas of doing Trump, and he mentioned Barry Blitt and me as sources that he's looking at. So that's kind of fun. I love what he's doing. Here's the potential cabinet. Sarah Palin, Nugent, Dennis Rodman. Not too different, not too far off from
me. Did we get off better?
I don't think so. Actually, these guys might have been better than what we have. This was an ad for the nation's subscription. The actual cabinet, a little scarier, I think. Well, Giuliani didn't make the cabinet. Before the end of the campaign, there were the cons and their opposition to Trump. And I just combined that with the comment about how he could shoot someone in Fifth Avenue and not do that. I made him laugh again. Isn't that great? I thought that was going to do him in. But, you know, I think a lot of what we do is rallying the troops. I think we're like Bob Hope. We're entertaining the troops in a way. And I feel like if you can just keep everybody feeling as though we're drawing the monster in a weakened state. But that's going to be easier and easier now. Here's the psychological effect of Trump for the Boston Globe.
You know, the truth is, there has been an upswing in patient tree ever since this has happened. And other neurological problems have decreased.
There was an article the other day on Slate, on The Guardian, about gaslighting. And I gave it as an assignment, if I have any students here, I gave it as an assignment the other day. The idea of gaslighting, which is the process, you ever remember the movie Gaslight with Charles Boyer? Where he tried to convince her that she doesn't know what's really happening, that everything she's seeing is wrong, right? You ever see that movie?
Yeah, I love that movie. Paula.
Yeah, Ingrid Bergman.
Right.
So there apparently are all kinds of people who have been gaslighted in their lives by their parents or boyfriends, who this is now sending into therapy, because it's bringing it back, it's bringing it up for people, which is pretty awful. It's really scary and awful. This is that piece, yeah, once again, for the nation, and then it got a lot of hits on social media. And then when I get profiled, as I have the other day, by Bob Newman, it got profiled there, and then it got used in protests. Why not? I mean, Edel and I, and here's my art director. I'm to let you see how things get made. But it's a whole thing now about not caring about copyright so much and allowing your work to be used, to be offered online. Hey, you know, use it. Take it to a demonstration, put it someplace. We're doing it for the sake of the movement. And that's a change. That's a good change that's happened.
Well, thank you, Steve. I laughed more than twice. I laughed in my heart most of the time.
I will carry that forever.
I don't know what we would do without what you've been producing all this time. And now Edel, who has created his share of amazing icons of this era, and it's funny to think that something so recent is going to be an icon, something that you will remember, and we'll see some of these as we go along, but you have a little larger story to tell.
So first of all, there's one thing I want to say about Stephen Heller, because we all have been through your office. So when I got out of college, I was 22, and I was one of the people in line outside his office on like 7 a.m., you know, that's when he was looking. And I went in, and I was like, hi, here's my work, and he this is him. You need color. Next.
We didn't even have color.
Because it was was a whole black and white portfolio. So I went back and I'm like, oh, Steve Heller said I need color. So I started putting color in my work. So any color you see, it's his fault. So there you go. And I never had the chutzpah to go back to him. I was too scared. So
I can show you his report.
Yeah, so this is my portfolio, Steve. Take a look, see what you think.
We'll talk in a few
minutes. Just don't flip through that fast.
So
okay.
I think the difference between Steve and I is I like the combination. Steve is really in the political world every day. You're watching, you're really kind of involved in it. Yeah, I mean, you go to conventions and all that stuff. And I see politics from like further away, and I see it more as the idea of propaganda and imagery and how that stuff can have an impact on people. I think it comes partly from having grown up in Cuba. I was in Cuba until I was 9 years old, and I grew up with things like this. So at a very young age, I learned the power of a symbol, of a graphic. That Che Guevara image that everybody knows is something that was everywhere in my life as a child. And I think it slowly over time, when I became older and started making art, I'm more interested in kind of the power of images in that way, not so much in characters, because I'm actually not very good at that. But you start finding out, what is it that you're good at? What is it that your use is good for? And that's what's really kind of developed over time. So these are some of the billboards that typically would be kind of in the countryside where I grew up in Cuba.
When did you come to the U.S.?
I came to the United States in 1980 during the Mariela boat lift.
So you went straight to Miami?
Yeah. So I went from Cuba then I grew up in Miami, and these are, you know, I've been starting to think, what is it, the graphics that I grew up with, where the colors come from, is it that? These are some of the posters that were in Cuba in the 1970s, like when you would go to the movie theater, this is the kind of posters that you would, because it was all made in Cuba. We weren't allowed to import anything from the U.S. or other countries, so the local artists would create the things themselves. And then these are some of the political graphics that I grew up with. And this is me as a little pioneer of the revolution with my beret. So from the time you're very little, you're inducted into this idea and this political thinking. That was a lot of my life. I wanted to be like Che Guevara when I grew up, you know. And then at some point, my parents started dreaming about leaving and getting out of Cuba. And my dad was a total black marketer. He was doing everything illegal, you know, in the country, you know, because everything was illegal. But he was in it because we needed to survive one way or another. And one of the things he would come across, he started meeting foreigners from other countries, and he started driving like the embassy. The guy from the Japanese embassy, he was driving around, he became his driver. And he got his hands on foreign magazines. And he decided to wallpaper the entire back of the house with ads from German magazines. So that, when he did that, that's when I started noticing advertising for the first time in Cuba, which I had never seen. And I remember standing like next to this wall just looking at everything, and I would draw pictures of what was in the ads. So so this was, you know, the back of my house. And then he was also a photographer, so he would have people come there and take pictures in front of these fancy things behind them. So it became this idea of advertising and another form of graphics got into my head at that time.
Edel,
yeah.
Did you find advertising to be just stimulating in a different way than anything else you had seen editorially in Cuba? Was something inherently fascinating to you about ads?
Yeah. It's glossy. It's everything, like the cherry.
Sensual.
The cherries had like, you know, little drips.
So these were all West German magazines.
Yeah.
So you were seeing capitalism.
Yeah.
In the flesh.
Yeah. And I liked it. But then in my head, it all got kind of combined. And then once I came to the United States, this is me on the boat with the red coat, and my father's behind me, and my sister, and then a bunch of delinquent prisoners all around us. Castro had emptied out the prison, so we rode the boat with about 80 prisoners and prostitutes and all sorts of people that Castro was trying to empty, and then we landed in Miami, and that's where the movie Scarface came from. You're welcome. You know, flash forward to 2005, Communication Arts asked me to create a cover for a special issue on Cuban design, and I decided to play with this image that I had grown up with, and just made a couple of little changes, adding the headphones and the Nike, because at the time, when I used to go to Cuba, I was always bringing food and medicine and things like that, and that year, people started asking me, can you bring us some iPods? And they didn't just ask for sneakers, they asked for Nike sneakers, Nike Resin. So I sort of halted and I went, what is this about? What is this branding, brand thing that's happening in Cuba? And I saw Che as a brand too, so I decided to kind of like bring everything together. And it's a very simple image, but it actually took a long time to...
Was this before the iPod commercial?
I don't remember, it might have been around the same time. But like we had to get like an okay from Apple, from Nike. I didn't get okay from the Cuban Revolution. So, but years later, I had a show 2 years ago, and I actually met the woman, the daughter of this photographer at the show. And I know she sued a bunch of people over the usage of this image. And I'm like, hi, how are you? But everything was cool.
She would have to sue a lot of people.
Yeah. But this is the first time that I saw an image that I made start doing things in a big way, similar to what's happening lately. It created a huge, it was a forum online where people were arguing for like a month about the meaning of this image and whether I had the rights to do it. The magazine CA was taken to Havana for Eco Grada, which is a conference, international designer conference, and people were putting it in bags and like passing it around because that was not allowed to be seen in Havana. But all the designers were like, hey, do you have that thing? Can I look at it? And because of that magazine, I then was able to meet about 10 or 15 Cuban graphic designers that found me. And they're like, whenever they left Cuba, they would come to New York and they would find me just to talk to me and meet me. So it was the first time that I learned the idea that an image can have such a lasting resonance. And then about 2 years ago, I started doing work about ISIS I saw what was happening in Syria. I was doing some paintings about Syria, and I realized that in this country, we weren't really paying attention to this story. We were obsessed with our own ideas and what was going on here, and I saw what was happening over there and decided to do a campaign to make people pay attention and notice. And that's mostly the way I work is I'm usually doing my regular work, and then I see something that grabs me and I feel I have to do something, and I get kind of obsessed with it. And this is the first time that I got obsessed with this campaign. And it relates to the Trump thing because it's the same thing I started doing later with the Trump thing. I saw him rising up and I started kind of like yelling and making images about it. But this is the first time that I did something about a particular subject like this. And from these images, then I started making posters and putting them on the streets and things like that. This is another image from that series. And I also put posters of this on the street, and as I'm putting up posters, I was thinking, like, what if people think I support terrorism, or I'm Middle Eastern, I'm trying to do something here, because police would be walking around when I'm putting up these posters. But nothing really happened from that campaign, and I'm showing these because they lead to something else later. So these are some of the posters on the street in Times Square. Then I started taking people kind of interacting with the posters, so it's basically in one picture what I'm talking about, where these things are happening in this world, and then the American guy in the front just watching TV and not really painting.
Then it becomes a photo project also.
Yeah. So it's a little...
The cops never stopped you from
No. I mean, later on I started doing Trump things and doing Trump posters and putting them up, and that's... I felt a lot of times people from other countries say, aren't you afraid that something's gonna happen or this and that? And I've actually had cops say, hey, nice job. there was a cop in Times Square and I had a bunch of Trump posters and I said, hey, I have this idea. I wanna just put them on the floor so people will walk over them. Would you be okay with that? And the cop goes, man, that's a great idea. And he's just sitting there, and he's like thinking about it. He's like, oh, I'd love for you to do that. I can't make you do that. It's like littering and so you get that here. You can't do, if you're in Cuba and you tell a cop, hey, I want to put a picture of Raul Castro and have you arrested immediately, or in Turkey or a bunch of other places. So there's a difference, and I want people to understand that, because having been in all these other countries and having grown up in a communist state, you have a lot of movement here, a lot of free will and freedom, and what I do is take advantage of that. You know, I freedom. You know, freedom isn't free if you don't use it. You know, what's the purpose of having it if you're just always afraid to do something and say something? And I've noticed that a lot lately, where a lot of people are kind of like hesitant to get into it, or they don't want any trouble.
Well, it is against the law. There are statutes. My son was busted for doing street art.
Yeah, there's levels. As long as you don't do any permanent damage or things
and
like that.
And depending on what neighborhoods you do it in.
Yeah. Yeah. Then I had a show in the Bronx at the Bronx Community College that included all of this work. And this was the poster that I did in 2015. And the idea at that time was that ISIS had gone so far with the beheadings and all this kind of imagery that they were kind of cutting off their own heads. They, as a group, they were, you know, beginning to end because they had become so extreme. So that's what this image.
And this is where your droplets start evolving.
Yes, yeah. This idea of blood and things like that. And this is another image from that series about that it's going to be forever. You know, this idea that extremism will breed extremism and it's going to keep on going for hundreds of years, I think. So at some point there was a turn and the election started, and I started in the primaries, I started seeing the right-wing extremists doing the same things as ISIS, you know, this very similar extreme way of being and being very violent in the protests and things like that. So naturally, I just switched everything up, and instead of the black ISIS figure, I switched it to a white Ku Klux Klan person. And I put this up. I started doing things on the internet mostly. I put this up on Memorial Day, this was also during that time. This is the idea that Trump was setting up a cabinet.
What was the response?
Oh yeah, on the internet it was. Everybody was like, "Wow, great job!" So it really kind of it started getting shared all over the place.
Trolls didn't get to you?
No, not at that time, not yet. At that time, it was all pretty supportive because I don't think I was getting that much notoriety. It was all kind of like amongst friends and some fans of my work and some sharing and some. That's when I started seeing, wow, I have a lot of really racist friends, because they would say, what do you mean, you know, and then mostly people I grew up with, like in high school and things like that, where they didn't get what I was saying or what I was doing, and then they started realizing, oh wow, these people that you think are a certain way, they're kind of, they have a different leaning on things. And then this was the first Trump illustration I did was for Political magazine. They asked me, I think it was just to do a general Trump portrait and what was happening during the primaries. And this is the first image I did was this kind of like Trump Medusa. Because to me, it was the first time that I saw a candidate like behave that way. That you just can't. You know, you can't figure out where he's at.
Sometimes he was right, sometimes he was left.
And it was kind of shocking to see someone be so so upfront with everything. I think that this was right around the time that he said McCain was not a real hero because he got captured in Vietnam. You know, and to me that would have sealed the deal. That's it. It's over. You know. Anybody that insults a soldier is just a horrible human being, in my opinion, in that way, for being a prisoner. That was the first thing. Actually, the first thing that set me off was the soldier thing. And then it became one thing after the other. And I started just working on anger by then. So.
All
This was also during the primaries. He probably said something outrageous, and I just got pissed. And
well, I think if de Blasio really had guts, he'd use these throughout the city.
Oh, I want to make these. I want to make little plastic signs and just put them around the city. So that, first I figure out the image, and then I find other purposes for it. So that's one of the things I'd like to do. Then this is during the primaries, pretty much whenever there was a debate, on debate night, I would put up an image. And this is the debate night image for the first night. And I just put them up as a prediction of what the I would say, like, a prediction of tonight's debate or something. And that's what it would show.
But as you were showing this, you were having a good time, right? You weren't afraid at that moment, were you?
No, I wasn't afraid. I'm mostly not afraid, only until recently and a few times. But no, I was having a good time, yeah, because it's so over the top, and I'm like I say, I'm mostly just reacting at about rage and anger, and I've never really been that involved in politics this way.
Can I ask you, did the fact that you worked for Time magazine for a number of years give you a more secure feeling about media and how protected it is in this country? You can see all kinds of things getting reactions, but you never really saw people at Time frightened.
Intimidated. Yeah, I mean, we would do all sorts of things at Time, and no, I've always thought of this country as a free press, and you can say whatever you want. I mean, that's one of the things I always work from, is when we arrived here, my dad said, this is the greatest country in the world, you can say and do whatever you want. So I just follow what my dad told me, and it's that simple. And if it's not that, then what's the purpose? Like, what's the purpose of having left my family and come here and get on a boat and, you know, get sunburned? We went through all this stuff to be here. So when you're here, you live freely, completely, or it's over, you know. So I'm going to do whatever I want.
Maybe immigrants understand that better than some people who have
learned. That's one of the things I've learned. I'm pretty shocked by it. That I've seen it more from people that are native born here, this cautiousness that something could happen to them, or something could happen to their career, or there could be some ramifications.
Well, there are also, we're talking about generations. There are generations that lived through McCarthy, mm-hmm. who still get the chills now in their 80s and 90s.
Yeah, my wife's grandmother is like more careful or scared for me than my mother, whatever. She grew up through the whole World War II, and I think they have more scars from these times. But I really do feel like, what's the purpose of living here if I'm not going to just do absolutely whatever I want anytime? So there you go.
If only.
And to me, what happens, if you start seeing through the image, I ratchet it up even more. I'm like, oh, wow, I did this and I didn't get in trouble for it. I'm going to do this other thing. And I'm going to do this thing. And you kind of like keep doing and pushing it and doing more. And that's when, what I mean is I actually don't sit around. And, that's why I said you work so hard. I don't sit around and sketch for like hours. I just sit there and I go, oh, yeah, cat. Yeah, cat eating him. Yeah, and that's it. And then I just have to make it.
But you know, it looks just like a cat.
Yeah, and
he always gets a likeness.
Most of this work is done digitally, so I just sit there on my computer. Like, I don't really want to paint. I honor you for wanting to draw him. I don't want to paint him. I have not that much interest in it. It's very, very detached image making. Okay.
Well, so this must have come quite easily.
Yeah, and for him, working with him is really, you just use the words that he says, or the latest thing that he's done, and kind of like reverse it and turn it back on him. And at some point, I really got into the idea that I'm having a fight with this guy. it's like he's a bully, and I'm like, you know, let's go. And it became that way, you know. And in other ways, I also felt like there was that weird, like a propaganda war, you know. He's got his propaganda thing going on. So I go, okay, well, I know about propaganda. I'm going to do my thing.
And it's that's what's happening, I think. It's a propaganda war on both sides, in a way. So.
Well, this is the one that begins to change the discussion a little bit.
Yeah, this is the cover for Time magazine. This came out in August during the election. This was at the time when he was going after the Muslim family, the parents of the soldier, the star soldier. So I had done many images in the past of this sort of dripping thing. I had done a portrait of Gaddafi that way when he was killed. And then the art director from Time magazine, DW, called me and he said, "Hey, we want to do a portrait of Trump, but we don't know exactly what he should look like. But we do want a portrait of him, and we're working with the idea that he's melting in some way, it's summer, it's hot. His campaign seems to be Meltdown." So right away I'm like, "Okay, yeah, I can do that, not a problem." So I started working on it, and I took out all facial features. It just didn't make any sense. All he was to me was just this mouth and this like orange goo. And I sent it to them, and I didn't hear back for like 3 days, 3 or 4 days. And what usually happens is when you do a Time magazine cover, you don't hear back, is they're not going to publish it. You know, they moved on to something else. So I moved on to something else, and then on Wednesday, I started getting things like online, like internet messages. "Hey, wow, published this!" And oh my God, they published it. I actually thought they weren't going to publish it, because to me it was such a leap for Time magazine to do something so strong.
They ran with it without announcing.
Huh?
They ran with it without announcing. They were telling you.
They didn't tell me. They didn't tell me. Just found out about it on the news, on TV. Yeah, so like friends started calling me and the internet started telling me that this thing was published. And I went, "Oh my God, they published it. They're nuts." So I always do everything out of be as extreme as I can and thinking it's not going to get published. And then when it does, I get surprised by it. And there was a huge reaction from everywhere. So it was, every cable channel started running it, talking about it. It was on NBC. That was on NBC News. Then later on, this woman put it on her nails. One of the highlights. I have no idea. I found it on the internet. So, and then later on, there's a second one, which that other one ended up on the. Someone drew it. That in the village on their chalkboard in front of a restaurant. So to me, that builds more encouragement. You know, you can, "Oh, great, okay, it's on. I got people supporting me."
So. It's interesting that it's on Morning Joe like this, because they were responsible in large part for this.
Exactly, and that's what I mean. You know, when this cover came out, I was on CNN interview, and it was about 4 minutes, and they said they were going to do a whole thing about my work and all this nonsense, and it was just 4 minutes of constant questions. Are you being fair? Is this fair? Are you being fair? And I don't know how many different ways I answered it. But the media creates this fairness thing, which they did with Trump, and then they realize they screw up, so they got to change the storyline.
Well, how did you respond to fairness?
I think my answer was, he's a jerk. Which I when I'm watching again, I'm like, "Oh my God, I just called him a jerk." And I couldn't think of anything else. I'm like, "What is this fairness thing? He's a jerk." And that's it. There's no.
But you know what's really interesting? This is similar to the thing that I talked about before with respect to the clown images. That this now is really, even though he was victorious and he won, since that time, this has now come to define him as he is now. This is really a melting down administration. And so this is going to have much more of a significance to it, I think, than we thought in November.
You're absolutely right, except somebody like Miller will get up and say, "We won."
Yeah, but how many times can you say that when your power is drifting away? I mean, there really is this power quotient in all administrations, and you can't argue with numbers. And then once the numbers go down long enough, flow enough, all kinds of, it shows itself in all kinds of stinky little ways. And he's going to be a very unhappy guy.
Well, maybe we can talk about strategy in a little bit.
All right.
So this, I think about 2 months later, I got a call to do, actually, at that time, you know, it was during, that's when he, the tape came out. That he,
Access Hollywood.
The Access Hollywood tape, yeah. Where he grabbed the women by this and that. So they wanted to do, that was going to bring the whole GOP down during the election.
Right.
So I actually, they wanted to do the GOP logo melting down. I'm like, all right, I'll type it in here. And I did, and I sent that in as the GOP logo melting down. That was going to be the cover for Time Magazine. And then Wednesday, on publishing day, they called me at 10 in the morning and said, we actually don't want to do the GOP logo anymore. The editor wants to run a secondary, more totally smashed down portrait of Trump, because they want to show Trump on the cover, and you have 2 hours. So from 10 to 12, I started frantically sketching this thing, and it was actually really difficult in like such a small amount of time to do that to a face, you know. So this is the pencil sketch for it, and then next, here are kind of like two versions of it, and I think I sent them this one within an hour, and then DW writes back, no, I think we want more of a, you know, like this. I'm like, dude, you have an hour. And he was treating it like a regular assignment with feedback and stuff. And then this is the final cover, which is Total Meltdown. And then I assumed, since we had already covered the press and all the issues, that was over. No, when this one came out, there was another yeah. Huge.
Did you hear anything from the campaign?
No, I haven't never heard anything from the campaign, but I'm sure they're watching.
And then you started doing street.
Yeah, then I started doing posters. I created a stencil, and I started just painting these stencil posters. They're about 40 inches tall, and putting them around New York City. So this one over here is at the Trump International downtown. So I just showed up there one night and I just dropped it on the coffee table and walked out.
And nobody said, I missed it, you forgot your picture.
No, I was so pissed, I'm like, here you go. And putting them up on the street, and then I went to Times Square.
The Disney character.
I don't know how I got this idea. I was going to put them on the walls, but then I saw these characters, and I started talking to them, and they're all like Mexicans. And they're like, and I'm like, hey, ¿qué pasa? ¿Cómo quieres? ¿Quieres ir a la foto? Trump es un chingón que se ve por acá. So all these people were like, yeah, we love to hold this point. So I made friends with all of them. So now I when I do projects, I go down there and they take pictures with all these things, yeah. And then
the
later,
end of the world.
Yeah, in November, right before the election, Der Spiegel called me and they wanted to do a cover where the threat was about to happen, because I think it was gonna come out the day before the election, right during the election. So they wanted to show an image that showed that, you know, sort of what's going to happen next and not really knowing. So what popped into my head was the idea of a comet. You know, we're on Earth and someone announces there's a comet coming. It could hit or it could avoid Earth. So since we didn't know what was going to happen, this is the image that I made. And then again, this blew up again on the internet and everywhere, and it ended up being the cover of the year in Germany. The sales of Der Spiegel went up a lot, so that was for that cover. Then during the inauguration, there was the Women's March coming up. I think the day after the inauguration. Mm-hmm. So I put up all the images that I had made, all the Trump images I made. I put them up online in all my feeds, and I told people, if you want to download them for free and use them on posters, please go ahead and do so. I had also made this poster for the Women's March, and I created that as a stencil. And I put up the stencil and told people to download the stencil and make their own posters. And some people did, and they started sending me pictures back from the protests of using my images. And this is one of my favorite images. I like, she's so like, you know, I like her attitude. This is from Los Angeles. And what's interesting, what happened with this image, it went in reverse. I created it for the Women's March, and then about a week later, Time Magazine asked me to do a version for them for their cover. So it went kind of in reverse. And then they printed something else, but they wanted to use it as the time cover. Then during the week when the Muslim ban was announced, the Muslim travel ban, Der Spiegel called me again to do like a follow-up, a second cover on what was happening in United States politics. And most of it about the immigration and the Muslim ban and all that kind of stuff. So I, actually before they called me, I had done this, sorry. I reacted to the news and I decided to take my Muslim image, which you had seen earlier, and I was so angry that I just put Trump's head on it and put the Statue of Liberty. And I put this on the internet on its own. And there was a big reaction, and everybody, you know, shared like 1,000 times or something. So then following that, Der Spiegel called me for sketches, and I think I sent them about 10 sketches for a cover on what was happening in the US. And they didn't like any of the sketches. And a couple of days passed by. They wanted me to do more sketches. I was just angry. I was like, no, I'm not gonna do more sketches. So I didn't get back to them. And in that time, I guess the art director got a little nervous. She started going through my Twitter feed and found that image I had done of Trump beheading the Statue of Liberty. And she emailed me and said, is this available? Have you published it anywhere? I said, no, nobody, you know, like, no one would publish this. We love it. We want you to do it. We just want you to change the Muslim garb for his regular suit. And I remember just looking around at everybody and that I know, go, they want to do this?
And this look is what happened to Angela Merkel.
Yeah. And this is the first time in all these covers that I thought this is going to be a really bad, complicated thing, or something's going to happen out of this. It's the first time. The other ones I thought were silly, but this one I thought was much more serious. And I remember I saw Mark Burkhardt at a party. He's like, hey, how's it going? I'm like, well, there's something coming out tomorrow. And I think it's going to cause issues. And as soon as it came out, it was all over the place. Then immediately, the day after, that image started popping up in all the protests. The magazine wasn't even out yet, and people had downloaded it off the internet from Der Spiegel site, from my site, and started making posters of it. And the magazine wasn't even on the street yet. So. And then this is some of the things that came out of that. Some of the, you know, my studio pretty much looks like that a lot, very often, recently. A lot of camera things. And then I went back on Broadway and I started putting up posters
so much fun.
Next to Broadway shows.
So much fun.
And Charlie Hebdo honored me with their own version of this, that she's beheading her opponent in the election there. And then these are some other images that I've done. This is just, like I said before, using his own words against him. This is another one when he started signing executive orders.
This one I love.
My mom said I went too far. That one.
She should be proud.
And this is another one for Der Spiegel that's coming out, but it's not out yet. And this is another one for Der Spiegel. And then this is a recent print that I did.
I think that magazines are being driven to be sharper now. Even the New Yorker cover that's out now, the one that's this week by Barry, have you seen that?
Yeah.
It's got an overweight Trump golfing balls into the White House, and all the windows are broken. Okay? You should look for this online, it's hilarious. But for the New Yorker, it's sharper. I think it's raising now the feeling of the imperative to go after this in a way that generally magazines and newspapers and websites have felt vulnerable to being called unfair in the
right.
past. And I think it's like the gloves are off.
Well, we don't have a lot of time, but I do want to get to one particular question, and if other people want to jump in very quickly. Is this doing us any good, or is it just making us feel a little better, that there is some control in our hands, and that control is really a mirage?
Well, I think what it does is it makes people think or realize that they're not alone, that, you know, when an image pops up that you go, well, okay, oh, they get me, they understand my anger. So it keeps those people involved. And I do think that there's people in the middle that are thinking, did I screw up? Did I make a bad decision? And they see an image and they go, huh, they give them something to think about. And there are elections coming up, so it might make them think, you know. But for the most part, I don't make images to change people's minds. I make images because I'm reacting, because I want to. And I don't, you know, I don't know how to do anything else.
But I wonder, has anybody in the audience met anybody in the middle or on the other side and had a response to images of Trump, whether they're on TV or in the press? You have.
Yeah, it's been absolutely crazy in some cases, because I would like share things that would just be humorous or something, or even something I made from the State of the Union, where I had Mitch McConnell shot and added sad trombone on it. And sometimes they would just like attack viciously, just stating that everything that I was saying was wrong or something. And it's like, well, this would be a funny parody on SNL, or this is an interesting parody, or this is something odd to point out. And even just something humorous would get like a vitriol response completely, not anything even as charged as these images.
Yeah, I have the same reaction when I put stuff that's political up on my daily blog. Whenever that comes out, that's when the letters come. And they're not trolls, per se. They're just designers saying, stick to talking about design and forget, get away from the politics.
I think there's another aspect to this that I just want to introduce. I think in the past, people on the left and the center left have been guilted into feeling that we represent the cause of fairness and ballast in a discussion, while the right felt that they could be bomb throwers and revolutionaries. And this went on all the way through the Obama administration. And I feel that the left has now come to Jesus moment, where they feel like, really, pardon me, fuck you. And that I, now, and I never used to do this, anytime I get a troll or somebody on Facebook who says, you know, you're a snowflake, libtard, da-da-da-da-da, my answer is, so happy I got under your skin. You made my day, bucko. And so what I feel I've done is I've put this person in contact with an opposing point of view that's not Breitbart or Fox. How marvelous. You don't have to agree. I don't think you'll ever agree. But I exposed you to another idea, another aspect of America that's really going on. And guess what? In many ways, it's working. In many ways, it's winning. The healthcare thing would not have gone down but for us. You know, the Russia thing would not be where it is without us. Chuck Schumer has grown a pair. Notice? Who would have guessed?
I mean, Steve has known me for a long time. I'm not a lefty nut, basically.
Yeah, we used to have conversations.
Yeah.
He would argue from the center. All
yeah, time. Yeah, because I grew
your
up,
background.
I grew up in a socialist country. I grew up in the left, and I left it, and I see in the end what can happen. So I'm not like that. I'm actually a pretty chill person. You know, it riled me up to become this crazy personality. So I think that I'm not anti-Trump. I'm anti-stupidity, you know. Everything they're doing is stupid. So I speak to it. And if you're post-stupidity,
and also, that's and your also, and also, mendacious.
Yeah.
Hateful of people.
Yeah, yeah.
Hurtful of people.
Yeah.
Right? It's not just stupid.
So I've always, you know, I'll make an image, and if someone questions it, I'll go, oh, maybe they have a point of view. I never felt so right about something.
And the sharing, these images too, that are being done are so fabulous, so fantastic, that people on social media that wouldn't have a tendency to step out, share it.
Yeah.
They look at it, whether it's a New Yorker cover, whether it's one of yours, Victor's.
Right.
Oh my God, it's on Instagram, it's on Twitter, it's on Facebook. And it just, perfect definition of viral.
And one of the things that set me off really at the beginning was when I would have conversations with people and they would be afraid to do things like that. Afraid to share something, afraid to say they're anti-Trump or they don't believe in it. Afraid, okay? I grew up around people who were afraid to say how they felt. I felt afraid to say, I'm against Castro, I don't like him. People would be like this. And when I saw that happening in this country, that's when it woke me up. And I said, no, this is crazy. You can't be like that in this country, okay?
So if we reach the point where there needs to be some sort of strategy where the bombs from the opposition are not enough, there has to be something concerted. Some, you know, the next election is in a year and a half or so, and that's going to tell a tale. What can designers, artists do to help that along?
What we've always tried to do is tell the truth. Just come in every day and tell the truth. And I think, you know, just that, without any kind of single person guiding the whole thing, is working. It's not only just good, it's working, okay? And it's working because there is a hive mind in this society where we're discovering there's a baseline of intelligence, there's a baseline of understanding what the Constitution says, even though the blob has never read the Constitution. We have. And you know, the question I had in November was, will there be a pushback? Will the civil society rise up, even though the Congress has taken over, the White House has taken over? Will we see the courts push back? Will we see the media push back? And will there be incredible grassroots that will get the Democratic Party to say, you know what, we are going to filibuster Gorsuch?
I don't think that the other side is going to get anywhere until they get very charismatic people to lead these things, okay? Because that a lot of people vote on charisma and personality and this, that, and the other. And if you have kind of like wilting flowers that don't really stand up on things and don't explain things to people that are not very well educated, and a lot of people that are not very well educated, and they're voting like crazy. So you have to speak to those people. You know,
it remains to be seen if that we can adapt well, that
when,
way.
When Hillary stood up, she would go down a whole list and be like, I'm here for the African Americans and the immigrants and the LGBT community, da, 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 da. And she never mentioned the white working class people. So you have to do that. You have to bring kind of everybody in and not make certain parts feel alienated.
Well, there also has to be a point at which Trump is not the sole target. That we can laugh at what we see done to humiliate Trump, to bring certain those truths out, but he's not the only enemy.
Yeah.
There is a revolution that's...
We have Mercers and Cokes, guys. Those are the real enemies. And I think that artists should have websites that are great catch-alls for what we're doing. And I've talked to Steve about this, and I've talked to The Nation about this. And I want to pursue this so that we have a place where, you know, there are highly publicized, highly spotlighted places where artists of all kinds can do. You know, Andrea has done an amazing job, and Francoise has done an amazing job, and that's, I think they're pointing the way. And I really do think that we should have some big places where all this work that's already existing, you know, street work. Not just by you, but all these amazing murals you see painted all over Europe and all over the United States. Put this up for everyone to see and just increase the thing that's already there. It shouldn't take much. But I think that's what a next step we need to do. I think it's coming.
On that note, I'm told we have to time out. Thank you. This was wonderful.